Good morning and welcome to this meeting of the Public Petitions Committee, which is meeting virtually. The first item on our agenda today is the consideration of continued petitions. The first petition is petition 1707, Esti Fibley Kathleen Orr. Petition calls on the Scottish Government to introduce a requirement for all new build or newly renovated or repurposed buildings with a floor space of over 7,500 metres squared to have a public access defibrillator pad fitted to the exterior of the building for public use and for the pads to be officially registered. At the last consideration of this petition, the committee agreed to hold a roundtable evidence session. This was originally arranged for March, but was delayed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The evidence session will go ahead today, but on a smaller scale due to the meeting being held virtually. I'm pleased to welcome Stephen Short, Clinical Effectiveness Lead for Out of Hospital Cardiac Arrest, the Scottish Ambulance Service, David McColgan, Senior Policy and Public Affairs Manager, British Heart Foundation Scotland, and Dr. Gareth Clegg, Senior Clinical Lecturer, the Resuscitation University of Edinburgh. And we also have with us today Stuart McMillan, MSP, who's joining us for the consideration of this petition. And Stuart is going to read out a statement on behalf of the petitioner before we begin the evidence session. So I can hand over to Stuart now.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, everyone. The statement I'm about to read out is from Kathleen Orr, and it starts. I would like to add to my statement that I've worked really hard on keeping Jaden's name alive and while keeping another child alive. I really feel that by making places have a defibrillator, they will be keeping themselves and others safe. I know myself that when I see a place with a defibrillator, I feel a lot safer. It's important to have signs to say that you have one, and where it is located can also help the public if they ever need to use one. Since I last sat with you and told you how much this means to me, there has now been a song made, and it is active on iTunes. An advert has also been made, and I'm waiting to launch that. Jaden's Rainbow is my family: John, my husband; Kerry, my daughter; Declan, my son; and myself. In saying this, it's mostly done by myself and Kerry. As you may understand, my husband John works and has to do so for us all, so he doesn't have much time to put in. My son Declan is still not ready to take part in much at all and likes to stay in the background. He's still hurting, and it hurts him to see me work so hard at a passion that I will never stop it. All I ask is that you try to get into my head and see the way I am thinking. My son was gone in a second, a young life gone in the blink of an eye. And I know that's a well-known saying, and you would have heard that someone say it before, but that is what really happened to me. Think the way I do, please. Fire extinguishers are law. Why? Because they can save a life, many in fact. It's the same with a defibrillator. It can save a life in the blink of an eye. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for Stuart. And I think we would all agree that is a very powerful statement, and we appreciate just how difficult it is for the family to have dealt with such a tragedy, but to be so determined to try and help others. So we very much appreciate that and recognise just the challenge that we have to rise to in relation to these issues. I should say that most of the questions in this session will be open for all witnesses to answer. And if you wish to respond to a question, please type R in the comment box now and then invite you to respond in turn. There may be a few specific questions that will be directed to a certain witness. If any of the other witnesses do wish to come in on one of these questions, again, type R in the comment. And maybe if I can open the questioning. The petition asks for a requirement for all new build or newly renovated or repurposed buildings with a floor space of over 7,500 square metres to have a public access defibrillator fitted to the exterior of the building. Do you agree with this suggestion? And if not, how should it be determined where pads are positioned? I don't know who wants to come in first on that. Do we start with Stephen Short, and then I'll bring in David.
Okay, good morning. Thanks, Minister. Morning, everyone, and thanks for inviting me along today. Yeah, I think it's a it's a very reasonable point in petition that's been raised by Mrs. Orr. I think it makes sense that you know, many of our cardiac arrests that happen in the public environment happen in areas with higher footfall. So if you have a larger building with higher footfall, more likelihood of a cardiac arrest happening, and so more likelihood of a publicly available defibrillator adding to the chance of survival quite significantly if it was to occur. So the simple answer is I do agree.
Yeah. Can I ask you where you think pads should, who should be responsible for deciding where pads are positioned?
So I think it's quite a difficult question to. Apologies. Yeah, so I think one of the key about a publicly available defib or a pad, as we call them, is that you need to have access to it 24/7. And I think one of the risks, if you don't have access to it, if it's for example, if it's locked inside the building, generally, you know, studies show us from around the world that that means it's not available somewhere between 50% and 60% of the time. And obviously, these busier spaces can have higher footfall because of the nature of where they are outside the building, out with these times. So I think, you know, the defibrillator being available 24/7 on the outer aspect of any building would be the most sensible advice to follow in this circumstance. And I guess in terms of responsibility for them, I think that would be the owner of the defibrillator, that we call them the pad guardian, if you like. They can ensure things like batteries and the pads that are as in that you stick to the chest, not the pad as in the defib, are all in day and rescue ready, as the term would be the safest advice, and also in keeping with our system that we use to register defibrillators in Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much. That, can I call David McColgan? Maybe he wants to respond.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, firstly, thanks for inviting us to the session today, and a huge thank you to Kathleen and the Orr family for all the work they're doing and bringing this issue to the Parliament. British Heart Foundation have already submitted some written evidence, which is available on the parliamentary website. And I suppose opposite to what Stephen alluded to, we don't support the key point of this petition about every new or refurbished building over 7,500 square metres having an externally fitted pad to it. There's a number of reasons for that. One of the major reasons is that we believe that it would exacerbate health inequalities around out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. So if we imagine in some areas of Scotland, say Glasgow, Edinburgh, Dundee, there will be a major increase of buildings that size. But if we were to go to somewhere like Wick or the island communities, you probably wouldn't see many buildings of that size. So we do have concerns around that. I think the principle of the petition is absolutely right. I think more public access defibrillators are a good thing. But I think we need to take a strategic approach, especially where potentially public funds might be invested or legal requirements on individuals. And there's two key areas that are missing to allow us to take that strategic approach. One is we don't actually know where every defib in Scotland is. So if we were to think about Stockley Hall Street in Glasgow, you might end up putting 15, 20 defibs on there because of the size of the buildings. But if you were to go out to Rutherglen or Hindland, you might not actually have many defibs there. And there's a lot of international studies that have shown that what happens with defib placement is you end up with over-provision in areas with lower incidences of cardiac arrest and under-provision in areas in most of them. And the other thing that we don't have at the minute in Scotland is a public accessible registry of where cardiac arrests happen. So people can't make strategic decisions to put defibrillators in the right place. Now, I say we don't have both of those things. However, there's major work going on in Scotland. So British Heart Foundation, Microsoft and Scottish Ambulance Service have been working on the circuit and the National Defibrillator Network, which will hopefully be able to map where all the defibs are in Scotland and allow the ambulance service to direct people to their nearest defib. And Gareth will probably speak to this in a moment, but the Resuscitation Research Council and group over at Edinburgh University have been working on a pad placement project that maps where cardiac arrests are and where pads need to go. So I think we don't support the 7,500 square metre provision, but I think this conversation is really important to understand and where government, local authorities and other organisations play a role in deciding and placing defibs. And you know, I think Kathleen's point is absolutely right that more defibs will give people an opportunity to A, use them and B, save lives. So we welcome the petition, but we would want to hear more conversation rather than just the 7,500 square metre provision that's in the petition at the minute.
Okay, thank you. Can I just check with you that in your submission you noted that was on you were on undertaking to gather national evidence on this subject, and has that work been completed?
So I think that that alludes to Dr Clegg's project is funded by Scottish Government on the at the Resuscitation Research Group. I think Gareth will speak to that, but
right, okay. You're not involved in that work?
No, the British Heart Foundation haven't been involved in terms of the delivery of the project. That's very much Dr Clegg's territory, and I would leave it to him to speak to that.
Sure. And thanks very much for that. In that case, can I call Dr Clegg to respond to the question?
Yes.
I asked, first of all, and then maybe about that issue about where we are with the research.
Yeah, good morning. Thank you. Just to maybe clarify the landscape a little bit, I'm here today with, I guess, three hats on. One is as an emergency medicine doctor in Edinburgh. I've worked in cardiac arrest for a long time, for a couple of decades now. And over the last 5 years, I've been chairing a group to deliver Scotland's strategy for out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. And Stephen Shaw and David McColgan are both sitting around the table with that group, trying to deliver a joined-up strategy for improving survival after cardiac arrest across the country. And I think it's important to highlight that because this strategy is multifaceted, and public access defibrillators is only one component of that. And it'd be wrong to think that pads by themselves would solve the problem of cardiac arrest. But they're an important part of solving the problem. In answer to the question, just allow me to make two or three important points. One is that public access defibs aren't as applicable in all parts of the country. And what I mean by that is that the fixed public access defibs stuck on the side of a building work well, or tend to work well, in areas of high population density. They're not so good for rural populations. Where people live spread out, public access defibs are too far apart, and they don't work very well. And we need other solutions for that. We need responders with defibs. We need other kinds of ways of getting a defib to the patient. But it's undoubtedly the case that where defibs are used by people who've been familiarized with them, survival from cardiac arrest is hugely increased. In casinos and airports, for example, studies have shown survival of up to 70%. The national average, you'll be aware, I'm sure, of survival in Scotland is currently around 10%. So the question is, how do we deploy these things in a way to make them as effective as possible? And I think this petition to have a top-down, to a certain extent, approach to encouraging defib use is to be encouraged. And the reason I say that is because we have done some work looking at where cardiac arrests happen in Scotland. We've looked at 7 years' worth of data. We know where the hotspots are for cardiac arrest. We also know where public access defibrillators currently are positioned. And David makes a very good point when he says there's a mismatch between where the defibs are and where the cardiac arrests are. So currently, about 5% of all cardiac arrests happen within 100 metres of a defib, which is the working distance, if you like, of a defib. If we took all of the defibrillators that are currently in Scotland and we spread them out using a data-driven approach, so we spread them out where they're most likely to be used, we would cover nearer 50% of cardiac arrest. So what that tells me is that the current approach of a bottom-up strategy for placing defibs is not working. If we allow people just to get defibs and put them wherever they want to, we won't cover cardiac arrest. The general public, the philanthropists who buy them and put them on buildings, don't live in the places where cardiac arrests happen. So there needs to be some kind of top-down influence on that. And Stephen Short makes a good point that areas where there is high footfall, which tend to be in bigger buildings, are areas where there tend to be more cardiac arrests. Not entirely. The majority of cardiac arrests, the vast majority, happen in homes. But cardiac arrests that are more likely to be successfully resuscitated happen in the community in non-residential areas. And I think for that reason, encouraging the use of defibs on larger buildings would be a good thing. But I think there's another important component to this that hasn't been aired yet, and that is the culture around cardiac arrest. So cardiac arrest, out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, is a significant public health problem. It's not a rare event. There are about 60 to 70 cardiac arrests where resuscitation is attempted every week in Scotland. There are probably two or three times that many calls to the ambulance service for cardiac arrests, but 60 or 70 arrests a week, and so they're not exceedingly rare, but survival is very low. And part of that is because people don't call for help, they don't do bystander CPR, and they don't go and use a defib, even where one is available. So there's a pressing need to change the culture around cardiac arrest, and I think the visibility of defibs on and around public buildings will be a help to changing the culture around cardiac arrest, making people more aware that defibs are a thing, that they should be used, that it's the normal and right thing to do to take bystander action if someone collapses near you and they're not breathing and not conscious. So I think we need a top-down approach. We need to change the culture around cardiac arrest. And for those reasons, I think something around or similar to the proposal that's on the table would be a good thing to look at. There'd have to be nuance around this. There'd have to be training, of course. People would need, in the buildings where the defibs are, would need to know what they are and what they're for and so on. So it's not just a matter of putting the defibs out there, but I think this would be a good thing. So just to come to the second question that you've asked very briefly, the research funded by Scottish Government to look at public access defibs. We've, as I've already alluded to, taken 7 years worth of data. We've worked with a group in the University of Toronto who've done this kind of work, international leaders in this kind of work, and we have prepared figures which are currently under review for publication and which will form a report to Scottish Government, which we are anticipating submitting before the end of this year.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's really helpful. I suppose in the context of defibrillators, is there a role for broader first aid training? This was something that the committee looked at before. So how you make the link between providing the defibrillator and people having the confidence to use that and other first aid measures. I wonder if you have a view on that. Dr. Clegg?
Oh, sorry, I didn't realise that was aimed at me. Just to clarify, do you mean, are you asking whether we should be trying to increase first aid training generally in the community?
Well, I'm wondering whether, from what you said, that there might be a comfort zone around providing defibrillator. If you don't do the other stuff that you've talked about, you know, the top-down thing is really important, but if you don't do the other stuff, it's maybe a false comfort.
Yeah, so that's an excellent point. So I think, if I understand you correctly, what you're saying is that it's not just enough to have the defibrillators out there, the pads, let's call them, out there, but people need also to be willing to use them, and that's absolutely true. So I think the crucial thing here is that, as I said right at the beginning, you can't take placing pads out of the context of the rest of what is commonly called the chain of survival. So there are four elements to that. People need to call for help, so they need to recognize there's a cardiac arrest, phone the ambulance service. They need to do CPR. they need to use a defib if there's one available, and then the cavalry arrive, and there's post-resuscitation care by the ambulance service, and then in hospital. And those first three elements are crucially important. And it's a culture thing. It needs to be the case in Scotland that people believe that using a defibrillator is the right thing to do at a cardiac arrest, just like throwing a life preserver is the right thing to do if someone's in trouble in the water, or reaching for a fire extinguisher is the right thing to do if there's a fire. And David and Stephen Short are both part of a wider organization in Scotland called Save a Life for Scotland, which is coordinated by my research group, involves all the emergency services, a lot of third sector organizations, right down to the small community responder groups. And over the last 5 years, we've changed some of the culture in Scotland around cardiac arrest. Bystander CPR rates were around 40% when we started there, about 64% now. And that is part of the journey we need to go on, as well as putting pads on walls. So you're absolutely right to say, in isolation, putting these devices on buildings isn't enough. But I think we need to have these devices on buildings nevertheless as part of that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can I bring in David McColgan, and then I'm going to ask Stephen Short if he has a view on this issue around the confidence to use the defibrillators, I guess. David McColgan?
Yeah, I mean, just picking up on Gareth's point, I mean, we know from international evidence that placing pads around the community isn't the solution to encouraging people to use them. So about 85% of people claim they're too scared to use one because they don't know how they work. Around about 84% of people say they're too scared to use it in case they hurt the person. So there needs to be an education program around this. And I think also, as Gareth's pointed out in the partnership to Save a Life for Scotland and the government's out-of-hospital cardiac arrest strategy, that public access defibrillators are part of a chain. So it's about people understanding how to enact the whole part of the chain for community resuscitation. So calling 999, starting CPR, and then using a defib if it's available. From a BHF perspective, for example, we have a community defibrillator program where we part fund defibrillators for communities. But if someone was to receive a defibrillator through that program, they also receive 10 CPR mannequins, and they have to make a commitment to supporting the community to learn CPR as well. Fundamentally, the chain of survival is only as strong as its weakest link. So if someone has a cardiac arrest and we all go running looking for a defibrillator, that person's chance of survival will massively decrease. Whereas if someone or individuals begin CPR while the ambulance service directs someone to the nearest defib, the chain of survival will work far more effectively. So proliferation of defibs is great. Visibility is amazing. However, I think we do need to understand that for many people, these are still quite scary pieces of equipment. But actually, if we can demystify and demedicalise them, I think we've got a greater opportunity of increasing that use of defibrillator where out-of-hospital cardiac arrest occurs.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. I don't know if you want to say something, Stephen Short, about that, the context for your work?
Yeah, I agree with everything that both Gareth and David have said so far. And I think including the UK picture, but also the international picture, is fairly consistent as well. So in other parts of the world where they've been making good progress in cardiac arrest, like we have been in Scotland, again, where we're seeing increased bystander CPR rates, it doesn't then follow that you see an increase in the use of pads. And I think, again, it's all the things that David and Gareth have alluded to, that you need this blended approach. If we take learning from some excellent parts of the world, such as maybe Denmark and Melbourne in Australia, where they took this blended approach of not just training about CPR, but also increasing training about AEDs, and making them more visible in the way that's being suggested within the petition, and ensuring they're registered like we already do, then the use of AEDs and pads being used. And it's just to again highlight, as the other two have said, this blended approach and increased awareness is key, and it's more than just making them visible.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I see Stuart Willen wants to come in.
Yes, thank you, Convener. It's just as a point regarding the visibility of the machines and also the access to them. Clearly, if they're more visible and people see more of them in their community, then surely there'll be a knock-on effect that actually that will help actually reduce people's fear of actually using the machines. I accept the point regarding training and people's confidence in actually utilising the machine, and that's something that Kathleen Orr has touched upon earlier, also in this committee. But to take away that fear by seeing more of the machines certainly clearly help by taking away the angst of potentially using the machine and people's perception that actually they're going to cause more damage as compared to harm and save a life.
Thanks very much. That might be something that we'll come back to when we hear more from our witnesses. Can I call Maurice Corey with a question?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. And thank you also to the petitioner for raising this very important petition today. Can I ask, now this is one for Stephen Short to start with, is the petition calls for the pads to be registered with the Scottish Ambulance Service and noting that if a pad is not registered, the 999 call handler is unable to direct a call to the nearest pad. Do you agree with the call for pads to be registered? And also, should the Scottish Ambulance Service be responsible for such a register and also including non-public pads also being registered? Stephen Short, would you like to start that off, please?
Yeah, thanks, Minister. Yeah, so we have a registry of defibrillators, as David Colgan mentioned, I think, in the first question. It's called the Circuit, so it's a collaboration between not just the Scottish Ambulance Service, but other ambulance services in the UK and the British Heart Foundation. And that's with the common goal of any publicly available defibrillator that is registered with us in Scotland, if a caller in Scotland phones 999 and it doesn't go through Scotland's call centre, because obviously we have piggyback services where our calls can go to at times of high demand, then that pad would be available to them as well. So I think, you know, the register of defibs is a hugely important part of this, and it's what a blended armoury, if you like. Call handler can direct the caller. Should there be an extra caller there, because obviously if there's only one caller, their focus should be on doing high quality CPR and not interrupting that. But where there's a second caller, they can go and collect the defibrillator and hopefully utilise it on that patient that's in cardiac arrest. So we have that system in place already and it's active. We have about 3,000 AEDs registered on it. I guess the challenge we have is we don't know what we don't know. So obviously the Guardian needs to register that with us, and we expect that there are many more out there that aren't on our system, but hopefully still available that the community know about. Does that answer your question, Minister?
Yes, it does. Thanks, Stephen. But the point is that, of course, what David McColgan said is that they were not registering everything. I mean, by no means was that all the pads registered in Scotland, and therefore there's still that gap. And presumably that would be hopefully filled by the time Microsoft and BHS, BHF and also yourselves, Stephen, bring together information. So hopefully there will be 100% noting of all the pads in Scotland, and certainly all other defibs as well. Can I come to Dr. Clegg? Would you like to make comment on that? Those answers from Stephen and points of my question?
Yeah, I think I agree with what Stephen said. I think it's self-evident that if people don't know where the defib is, they can't use it. So it needs to be signposted well to the people in the locality, but also if it's visible to the ambulance service, they can then make that device available to a bystander on the phone who maybe doesn't know where the nearest defib is. So it's absolutely crucial that the ambulance service, who are the people who coordinate a response to cardiac arrest, and let's just remember that after cardiac arrest, every minute where the patient is not receiving any kind of resuscitation reduces their chance of survival by 10%. So after cardiac arrest, the chance to intervene is literally 5 minutes long. So there is no time to go and find a defib. So it's crucial that they're registered with the ambulance service for that reason, but also just to raise an important point, defibs have a battery in them which has a shelf life. They need to be tested on a monthly basis and need to be checked to be in working order, and that information relayed to the ambulance service. About 40% of the defibs in the community that the ambulance service knows about are not available to be used because that information isn't available. And that's a very important point, because if the defib has a flat battery and the ambulance service then send a bystander to go and retrieve it, to bring it to the patient and to use it, then the defib essentially just gets in the way and will reduce a patient's chance of survival. So it's crucial that not only the defibs are known about, but that they're checked and in good working order, which is something that sometimes gets lost in this conversation.
Right. So what you're saying is basically the register should include those that are active and 100% in working order, Dr. Clegg.
Yes, it's really important. And there have been incidences where folk have been sent or have been aware of a defib, they've gone and collected it, and the defib has not worked. These things have a four-year battery in them. It's not an onerous task to keep them in working order, but it needs to be done.
Right. So coming back to Stephen Short, is that possible, therefore, to include the information in your register going forward, Stephen, about the batteries?
Yes, that is already included. So the way the circuit's set up is the guardians of the pad give us that updated information, and that keeps it automatically in the system. That information, the way the circuit's set up, is that means that that pad committed from visibility to a call handler, and then the guardian of the pad is given repeated requests to update the information for us as a safety net for all those points that Dr. Clegg raises.
Okay, thank you. And finally, to David McColgan, how would the register fit in with the British Heart Foundation's National Defibrillator Network, David McColgan.
So basically the register or the circuit or the National Defibrillator Network are all the same thing. They've just developed names over time. So the circuit, I suppose, is the PR marketing name for the National Defibrillator Network. But as Stephen and Gareth said, when we developed the National Defibrillator Network, Scottish Ambulance Service were one of the vanguard sites. So we were able to work with them and West Midlands Ambulance as well to make sure that all the functionality was there that was required. So, for example, the point that Gareth made, we don't want the ambulance service to send someone for a defibrillator that we know doesn't work. So we've built in functionality. So guardians of the defib will be notified on a regular basis to check battery and check the consumables like the razor, scissors and pads. And if it isn't functioning, it will then be hidden from the call centre, so they wouldn't send someone to it until it was functional again. So the best example would be where a defibrillator has just been used on an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. That would be removed from the system because we know we need to order new pads and we need to do the checks on it. And so that's all built in there. I mean, the point on registration is really interesting. So currently in Scotland and across the UK, no one is compelled to register their public access defibrillator on the network. So we only have defibrillators on there that people have willingly registered. I know at the minute Anna Sarwar, MSP, has got a members bill looking at mandatory registration of public access defibrillators in Scotland. So if a community group was to fundraise for one, they would then be required to register that with the ambulance service. My understanding is in the consultation phase that's had considerable support, and Anis is going to publish the results soon. But I think the registration and readiness is really important. And what we do know where places that use these sort of systems, so Denmark, Copenhagen's a great example, it really creates a community. And that point that Gareth was making, that they understand what defibs are, they recognise them in the street, they feel a lot more comfortable around them rather than these things on a wall that people might be scared of. So I think it all plays a big part in the whole system.
Very good. And coming back on that point, the fact of the first responders groups involved, they're obviously key to this as well, aren't they, to both the Scottish Ambulance Service and yourselves, David, in this planning? And you presumably you involve them as well in the planning.
Yeah, I mean, 100%. I mean, fundamentally, organisations like the British Heart Foundation can have the greatest ambitions we want, but individuals on the ground driving change will be the ones that do so. Prosex Search and Rescue are hugely influential in what they do. East Nuke First Responders and Fife are really key individuals to not only register the defibs that they have in the community. Many of them will act as the guardians to the defibs, so they will be the ones doing the checks. And also, as Gareth and Stephen have alluded to, often they will very much be the first people on the scene when the ambulance service are called for an outforceful cardiac arrest. So very critical to the whole process.
Thank you very much, Denise. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, I think Dr. Clegg's wanting to come back in.
Just a couple of quick points. One is just to bear in mind, actually, picking up on the last thing that was said, all of the community first responder groups in Scotland are coordinated by the Scottish Ambulance Service. So they're trained and accredited and activated by the Scottish Ambulance Service. So the Ambulance Service is very integrated in their activity. But the point I wanted to come back on mainly was, it's been sort of raised indirectly in the conversation so far, is that this petition essentially tries to move the balance of responsibility, if you like, for public access defibs in the community away from solely being the responsibility of philanthropists or community groups or charitable organisations to do something locally of their own accord and move some of the responsibility towards central government, Scottish government, to influence this from the top down. And I think that's a very important component to this. I think it would be a mistake to put the burden of responsibility for things like the registration of defibs, for example, onto individual philanthropists. I think it's a really good idea that all defibs are registered. Of course I do. I think that's absolutely fundamental. But I think if we're going to use a legal instrument to try and make that happen, it should be in the context of health and safety of companies as part of regulatory requirements, not on individuals and charities who are trying to do their best for the local community. So just to reiterate what I said earlier, DFibs have been around for a long time. The chain of survival has been around for 30 years. We've tried to change the culture around cardiac arrest and get DFibs in the right place for an awful long time. Community groups, different charities, British Heart Foundation being one of them, have tried to do this. And the data that we're about to publish shows that it has failed, that we currently cover 5% of arrests. So it's my strong view that actually we need some kind of top-down approach to strengthen where we put defibs and how we get them registered. If you look at countries, we've talked a lot about Denmark and in this conversation already, because they've turned around their survival from cardiac arrest significantly over the last decade. But they've done it by using a range of approaches which have included compulsory CPR training at the point at which you get your driving license, for example. Compulsory CPR training during school. Not only that, but there are lots of bottom-up initiatives they've done, but it needs to be a both-and rather than an either-or. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that. Stuart Millens, wanting to come back in?
Thank you, Convener. I think just to touch upon a couple of the points that have been raised there, I'm very much aware that that Kathleen Orr and the Jaden's Rainbow campaign, any defibs that they have put out into the wider Inverclyde community, first of all, caffeine ensures that they are registered, and secondly, that caffeine checks them every 2 weeks to ensure that they are they're fine and they're operational. But it's also a message that that she really kind of drills home to the hosts of these machines, that just for them, just to kind of to check them on a regular basis too. So I think the point, obviously, by the other speakers is very much well made regarding the importance of the DFibs and also making sure that they are operational. I think just one other point, if I may, and that's the issue regarding the location of them, once again, and certainly with the work that has been undertaken within Inverclyde by Kathleen, There was a joint piece of work between Jade and Rainbow, and also it was one of the universities in Edinburgh to map out exactly the hotspots within Edinburgh Clyde. And so where these machines are being placed, it is to actually go into the target areas. That's the main focus, as compared to just like a wider approach. So I think there's already kind of an example of that activity taking place in Edinburgh Clyde that others in the panel might want to be very much aware of, and also kind of talk to others about. And because it's, I think, some of the points have been raised regarding the potential just kind of placing a DFIP anywhere within a location. Clearly, it might not be fully beneficial for some communities.
Okay, thanks. Can we move now to David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. As we've heard in earlier evidence, 85% of the population up there are not confident in using public access defibrillators. How can we increase that confidence in members of the public to use PADS when they're needed to?
David?
Do you want me to?
David McColgan, sorry.
Thanks, thanks, David, for that question. I think it's a really important one. As Gareth said, there's a whole international evidence has given us a whole range of examples to do it. So parts of the world where you have to learn CPR/first aid before you get a driver's license or being compulsory in school. So we know, for example, we know in England that CPR training and advanced or early life-saving skills is now mandatory on the school curriculum. We know in Scotland that's not possible due to Curriculum for Excellence, but British Heart Foundation's National Lifesavers campaign gained a commitment from every local authority to make sure CPR training and life-saving skills would be taught in their schools. I think the National Lifesavers programme that BHF has covers CPR and defib use. And I think, as Gareth alluded to earlier, we need to make sure that where we are teaching CPR, we're also teaching the second part of that chain of survival around defib use. I think it's about familiarisation. It's about opportunity to see one of them in action. So there's a whole range of training defibs that don't deliver in talks, but talks you through it and actually demystifies and demedicalises the use of a defib. I think too many of us in Scotland still remember ER and the big pads that they rub together, and that gives everyone a bit of a fright about it. But actually, these devices, you know, talk you through the whole process from start to finish, which is fantastic. And I think you know, the work that the Scottish Ambulance Service does with communities is really important in that. And the Save a Life for Scotland partnership has been absolutely instrumental. So, for example, work that they did with I think it's the Scottish Butchers Association. So nearly every high street in Scotland has a butcher's on it. They're all now trained in CPR and use of a defib to respond to anything that might happen. British Heart Foundation, for example, had partnership with a whole range of high street, high street located organisations like Santander Bank or Barclays, where we went and trained staff in CPR and defib use. And actually, when we trained Barclays, I think 3 days after one of our first training sessions, somebody from one of their branches went out and saved someone on the high street. So I think it's about taking that multitude approach to training people. You'll know yourself through movements like the Scouts, the Boys Brigades, etc. There's an opportunity just to create a culture, as Gareth referred to, and that's what it's about. It's a culture of saying, I want to help, I can help, and I'm willing to help. And it's just trying to touch on all those points in people's life, life where they will have an opportunity to learn these things. So the solution's not throwing it into schools, because schools have loads of things to teach, but we've got a whole range of groups around us, like uniformed youth groups, organisations that want to help out, and just really changing the culture in Scotland, really.
Okay, David Torrance, you want to ask another question?
Come back in there, Convener. You mentioned youth organisations, which are very, very good at training for first aid and CPR, things like that. But how do we reach a broader audience? Because it's to give them that confidence. Should the Scottish Government have a national campaign, or is it to be left to these individual charities out there who do it?
Dr. Clegg?
So the Scottish Government does have a national campaign that's Save a Life for Scotland. It's been running for 5 years, and as said earlier, all of the major third sector groups with an interest in improving survival after cardiac arrest are part of this. And so I think one option would be to, for Scottish Government, for example, to inject more funding into Save a Life for Scotland. That would be a very effective way of getting the message out. But can I just say, just to be slightly, not facetious, but to state the obvious, one mechanism for increasing the awareness of the public and willingness to use defibrillators would be simply to make defibs compulsory in non-residential buildings as part of a health and safety assessment, risk assessment, in the same way that the use of fire extinguishers is, and for familiarity with CPR and defibrillator use to be part of health and safety training. And the analogy with fire extinguishers was made in the opening comments, and I think although it's not a perfect analogy, it is very strong. I mean, the Regulatory Reform Fire Safety Order was introduced in 2005 in the UK during the time when there were 470 fire-related deaths in the UK every year. And there are currently something like 27,000 cardiac arrest-related deaths in the UK every year. And I don't think it would be unreasonable to make public access defibs as ubiquitous and familiar to the public as fire extinguishers. The cost, of course, of defibs has always been a hurdle to that, because they have historically been very expensive pieces of kit, about £1,200 each. More recently, several groups across the world, including one group in England, are on the brink of manufacturing these things for about £200 each, which brings them in line with industrial size fire extinguishers. So I think it's worth reflecting on the parallel between defibs and fire extinguishers as we begin to think about how we make these things more available and familiar to the public.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Can I just say to Stuart that what I'll do is I'll afford you the opportunity at the end to come in and maybe make comments, so that we can, it's really just in terms of managing the time. So I promise you I will let you come back in at the very end, sum up from your perspective on behalf of your constituent, and I think that would allow us to make sure that you've been able to have an end to this. Can I call Maurice Corrie, who wanted a follow-up question?
Thank you, Ian. Just a very quick one to Dr. Clegg. Your last comment there. Are you then saying that it would be possibly a consideration for the Scottish Government or UK Government to consider in the Health and Safety and the Factories Act to include defibrillators in factories, for example, along with, as we have already, fire extinguishers?
Yes, I think a very strong case could be made for the life-saving potential of defibrillators being at least equal to that of fire extinguishers. And one mechanism for improving the safety of the public, but also improving the familiarity of the public and understanding of the public with these devices more generally, would be to include them in the health and safety legislation that we currently have for non-residential buildings.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks. David Torrance, did you have any last questions?
Yes, I do, Convener. David mentioned that training in school, it shouldn't be compulsory there. I'm just wondering if there's any other thoughts on that, because a young person who's trained up in CPR and the use of defibrillators is very confident through the rest of their life, whereas older people find it more difficult to accept these sort of training and do it. So I'm just wondering why it shouldn't be compulsory in schools.
David?
There's lots of examples where CPR training and defib use is compulsory. I think one of the really interesting things that we felt at British Heart Foundation around training in schools was generally everyone in Scotland will attend school, whether you come from an affluent community or you come from a poorer community. We do know, for example, that some of them routes to training are more acceptable, are more accessible for those who are from an affluent community. And Gareth will, you know, be much better at communicating this than me. But we know also that out-of-hospital cardiac arrest is more likely to appear in poor, or happen in poorer communities in Scotland, where you're less likely to receive bystander CPR. Now, that may have changed because of the work that Save Life for Scotland have done. So for us, the schools campaign was really important. I think you're right about young people being, you know, ambitious and willing and really keen to get involved. It's a fun break from maths and English, I suppose, is to go and learn CPR. But I think also what's interesting about schools is you have a conveyor belt of a new class every year coming through. We reckon that it equates to around about, I think, 55 to 60,000 kids a year would be trained in CPR. That's classed as an S4 cohort. So within 10 years, you'd have 500,000 people in Scotland who are CPR trained, defib ready, if you would. So that's why for us, schools is really important. But I think it's also real important to recognise this is not the only place. So workplaces are really important. You know, employers and, you know, I think Gareth maybe will go to talk to us again, but I'm sure it was NHS Borders was the first NHS board in Scotland that trained all non-clinical staff in CPR and defib use. So the NHS is one of the biggest, if not the biggest employer in Scotland. If you trained all administrators and all staff that were attached to that, that would be a massive cohort of people going back out into to communities that are ready to perform CPR if and when an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest happens.
Okay, thanks. I'll call Dr. Clegg and then Stephen Short. Dr. Clegg.
Thank you. Thank you. Just David, you're absolutely right. Just 2 points. One is out-of-hospital cardiac arrest is a condition which affects the poorer communities in Scotland disproportionately. We've done the work on this. My group has the National Cardiac Arrest Report, and people living in SIMD, one community, so the poorest 20% of the country, are twice as likely to have a cardiac arrest as those in SIMD5. They're 30% less likely to survive to discharge from hospital, and they tend to be 6 or 7 years younger when they have their cardiac arrest. So there is an issue that anything that we do to try and solve the problem, which is more accessible to more affluent communities, like buying defibs autonomously, for example, raising money, is potentially likely to increase that gap between the more well-off and the less well-off. The other point I wanted to make was just, I agree with David's comments about training in schools. And one thing that's important to remember is an effect which has been seen across the world called the multiplier effect. And what that means is if you train a school child, particularly a primary school age child, how to do CPR or use a defib, they will go home generally and teach their or communicate with their caregivers, their parents and grandparents and so on. And in more than one study now in the international literature, the average number of people who learn CPR if you train one child is 2.5 or 2.7 people. And the average age of the person that learns CPR is 50. So one mechanism for reaching middle-aged men who are difficult actually to communicate with this message is to train their kids at school in how to do CPR and use a defib. Thanks.
Okay, thanks. Stephen?
Well, actually, Gareth's just stolen the point I was about to make about the multiplier effect, but I think the little bit I would add into it is, you know, the word that's come up repeatedly today is confidence. Because I think, you know, what we know is one of the big barriers to all this, whether it's CPR or using a defib, is the members of the public are afraid of causing harm or making things worse, and it all comes back to confidence. And I think, as well as the multiplier effect, I think that's the other thing that children can do for their parents and grandparents and whoever else they're around who are older than them. Their willingness to pass on the information actually can help with that confidence piece, which I think is really important.
Okay, thank you. David, did you have any last questions or have you finished?
No, David, I'm finished, Kavina. Thank you.
Okay, that's grand. Thank you. Tom Mason?
Thank you, Kavina. Welcome to the panel. I want to bring your thoughts down to the practical issues. Many of the pads are installed inside inside buildings or in locked cabinets and are really only available during business hours. But this, of course, keeps them in good order. How can we ensure that pads are installed, are available 24 hours a day around the country? And if they're not installed inside, how do we ensure, and are outside liable to damage, how do we ensure that they're all in working on a continuous basis and somebody takes responsibility of them?
Shall we start with Stephen Short?
Yeah, thank you. I think, so I guess it comes back to some of the points that have been made by Mrs. O'Reilly within the petition, and you're absolutely right. You know, there is a significant majority of the pads that are registered with us that aren't available 24/7, because they're in a locked building that isn't 24/7 available. So I think the premise of the petition that pads should be on an outer within a case, I think, is really important. And in terms of safety, actually, we don't have a big issue of pads either being stolen or being willfully vandalised. It does happen rarely and on occasion. I'm not going to say it's a never event, because it does happen. But actually, I think the key to this, again, is the public awareness piece. And when people understand why they're there and what they're for, and particularly when you're targeting that awareness towards our young people through the schools programmes, then I think that's where we find most successfully they don't get tampered with or damaged. But that, the issue of availability is a really important one, and certainly being within cabinets and the outer aspect of buildings, I think, is something we would encourage. We also, when people ask our advice, we do encourage them to put them in an unlocked cabinet. We understand, though, that they're expensive pieces of kit, and the guardians do get nervous about that, but I guess to provide some reassurance, within the circuit system, so the DFIB registry, if there is a locked cabinet, the guardian will give us all that information, and the code to the cabinet is available to our call handler when they identify that pad, so they can pass that information on to the caller.
Thank you. David McColgan, do you want to say something about that?
Yeah, I think all the points Stephen made are really valid. I mean, I would come back to a point that Gareth made earlier on in the conversation, and I actually think a lot of this comes down to national leadership and national direction, or even regional, like for Inverclyde example, where the placement of DFIBs or the purchasing of DFIBs can be more readily advised, and the ambulance service provide a lot of that already. And I think actually if we can, you know, proliferate that example, that would be great. Now, a lot of employers will purchase a DFIB to be held within their building for their staff. So if they've got 300-400 staff, they may want a DFIB to be centrally located. But how could we encourage organisations like that to also think about it as a corporate social responsibility model, where they may purchase another one to put on the outside of the building as well? It was one of the frustrations, for example, that we felt at British Heart Foundation when the Scottish Government invested in defibrillators for dentist surgeries, because dental surgeries tend to be open 9 to 5. And if you have a cardiac arrest on the high street at 6 o'clock, chances are you're not going to get the defib out of the surgery. But I think it's about understanding, it's about awareness, and it's about that communication and guidance to place it. And the locked, unlocked cabinet debate, I think, will forever exist. And, you know, from a British Heart Foundation perspective, we prefer them to be unlocked because they're much easily accessible. However, the circuit has built that function in. If you do wish to use a locked cabinet, that we know the ambulance service have the code, and you can access it when you get there. So, yeah, I think there's a lot of work being done around this, but some form of national leadership and direction around the placement and siting of DFIBs would be really welcomed.
Thank you. Dr. Clegg?
Thank you. Yeah, three quick things. The first is that I agree with David that national coordination of where we put DFIBs is really important. And I'm glad to see that the information that we gave to St Andrew's First Aid about Inverclyde has been actioned, and that has guided the placement of the DFIBs there. And that was essentially a test case. But is this intelligence that we can provide from the data actionable? And it sounds like it is actionable. The other thing I wanted to say was on the back of Stephen's comments, the only defib I'm aware of that's been stolen three times from the same location is the one outside St Andrew's House. But I think that's an unusual set of circumstances. And generally, it is rarer that these defibs are stolen. I wanted to finish with a story from Craig Miller in Edinburgh, which, if you live in Edinburgh, you'll know is one of the less salubrious areas. They had a cardiac arrest in a community centre. They raised money as a community to buy a defib, which they put on the outside of the building. And as Stephen said earlier, the community ownership of that defib is absolutely crucial. It won't be stolen or vandalised because the community view it as their defib, which is there for the benefit of their community residents. And one, the defib was opened, and in fact, I think it was a member of Scottish Government was there to declare the defib in use. And one of the local residents said, look, this defib is a clear signal to us, who often have a lot of bad press in Edinburgh and a bad reputation, but this defib on the wall is a clear signal that the lives of the people in this community matter. And I think it's important to keep sight of the fact that public access defibs are life-saving pieces of equipment, but they're also symbols. They're reminders about what to do in the case of a cardiac arrest. And they're also reminders, actually, that the community are looking out for each other and will take action in time of need.
Thank you for that. Tom Mason, do you want to ask anything further?
Yes, just one further query, really sort of exploring a bit. Will technology, Wi-Fi and G5 and all the rest of it, the Internet of Things, help in terms of looking after the defib locations and registering them, whether they're in service or not, and whether the batteries are up to scratch, et cetera, et cetera? Is there a forward view there?
I don't know who wants to answer that. Basically, you know, will modern technology address some of these questions? David McColgan first, maybe?
I'm probably going to leave this to Gareth because he'll know the answer to this, but I think the short answer is yes.
Okay, we like short answers. Dr. Clegg, then?
Well, David's entirely right. The short answer is yes. These defibs already exist. We had a pilot project in the northeast in Grampian, where first responders were using these high-tech defibs that had built-in Wi-Fi and can send regular signals back to the base to say the pads are still in date and the actual adhesive pads are still in date and the battery is still working, all the rest of it. Of course, the big barrier there, Tom, is cost. Those units cost about £1,200 to £1,800 per unit, whereas the basic bargain basement, you know, if Aldi made a defib, this is what it would look like version, is about £200. So that would be the only impediment at the moment. But certainly looking to the future, yes, technology could make all of this stuff a lot easier to do.
Thank you. Stephen Short wants to come in.
Yeah, and it's just to add, I think the industry, you know, the manufacturers of these pads are very acutely aware of this as well, and I think it's something they are actively striving to achieve because they understand that the more helpful and the easier it is to maintain the public access defib, the better it is for the community. So that's encouraging that you have industry buy-in to this, I think.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Can I move now to Gail Ross?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thank you for your evidence so far. I want to start off with just a quick question. I was interested to hear about the open cabinet, closed cabinet kind of debate. And obviously, you know, as was said, we would prefer if they were all open and easily accessible. And there hasn't been a lot of vandalism, which is really, really welcome. But as with everything, you know, the more of them you put around and the better known they are, possibly the more vandalism there may be. So just a question to Stephen Short, first of all, in terms of the code system, so the paramedics and the first responders would have that code, I think you said. When the call is made to 999 and the caller is directed to the nearest DFIB, are they also given a code for the cabinet? Is that available to the member of the public that then phones?
Yeah, so just to clarify, so our responders who are tasked to the event, so whether that be our own frontline crews or our first responders, they wouldn't have that code because they would have their own defibrillators with them, so they wouldn't require the publicly available one. When the Guardian registers the pad on the circuit, part of the questionnaire that they fill in will include whether it's in a locked or an unlocked cabinet, and if it's in a locked cabinet, they then tell us what the code is. And that's on the system, so that appears automatically on the call handler screen within ambulance control, so they can tell the caller what that code is.
So that's another good example of why they should all be registered, really, because if you've got one that was, you know, bought by a charity and hasn't, or they haven't realised that, you know, they should be registered, then nobody would have the code.
Yeah, and we wouldn't know about it, actually. I mean, you know, our call handler in that context wouldn't be able to signpost a caller to it because we wouldn't know it there. I think what you tend to find, and this is a bit anecdotal, I guess, but what you tend to find in that context is the community knows it's there, though, and they do know how to get access to it often. And a lot of the stuff that both Dave and Gareth and myself have alluded to is it's that community ownership of this piece of equipment, and so they're kind of fully aware of it. And we try and engage with the communities at this early stage and say, look, this is why we don't want it locked away. But, you know, they cost a lot of money, and understandably that makes people nervous.
Do you ever get and again going back to the charities that raise money for them, maybe a bit nervous, or maybe the ones that aren't kept up to date with the kind of health checks and batteries and stuff like that, maybe because somebody doesn't want to take responsibility for it, because it is a huge responsibility keeping them up to date because they basically save lives. So what advice, I don't know, maybe could come from, or maybe already does come from the manufacturer, so, you know, it's already there so that they know exactly what they have to do. Is that happening already?
Yeah, so I think to a point it is. Through the OHCA strategy delivery group that Gareth chairs, and actually with some support from the British Heart Foundation, we do continually engage with the industry on this and ask them to come up with solutions for that. So, you know, one obvious example would be if you buy a defibrillator in Scotland, whoever sells you the DFib has to make you aware of how to register it, for example. That could be a simple solution. So I think there's early ongoing work with that, but it's not yet the solution. I think what we do have in terms of some of those anxieties for the Guardian is when you first register your pad with the circuit, it's a very upfront system. It's very clear what the expectations to have the public access DFIB are for the Guardian, and it's all very clear and very easy to understand. So, and in a supportive way, which is important. Whilst it's clear and upfront, it also supports them to be able to do this.
Okay. Can I go to I can't remember who it was. Was it David that said about compulsory CPR training through driving licences? And it was mentioned about schools as well. There's been, because it's obviously very difficult for the Scottish Government, given the autonomy of local authorities and education departments, to mandate anything in schools. But I just wonder, probably David, has the British Heart Foundation had any input into the PSE review that was happening to see if maybe that would be something that could be included in that subject in schools?
Yeah. So So in 2018, we launched our National Lifesavers campaign, which was working with individual local authorities. So we spoke with Scottish Government, and it was clear that there was no ability to mandate because of the autonomy of education and curriculum for excellence. So we spoke to all 32 local authorities. All 32 local authorities signed up to the campaign. Many of them have already enacted both statements through their full council meetings and have put programmes in place. I mean, what we should recognise is that pre-2018, there was a lot of local authorities already doing this. So I know, for example, North Lanarkshire had CPR training in all their schools already. There were other local authorities that had none. What's interesting is when it comes down to teaching CPR through schools, is there's a whole myriad of approaches that local authorities take. So we had some schools that were using PE as the mechanism to teach CPR. We had some schools that were using biology, other schools that were using personal social education, and other schools that were just led by individuals within the school. So a school in Edinburgh where the librarian was really passionate about it. So I think the challenge around teaching CPR in schools is that we can't mandate it in Scotland. It's just not possible. But we also have to recognise that there will be regional and school-specific cultures around it. So a good example is Blairgowrie High School. I think it is that at the end of the summer term every year, they basically teach the whole school CPR in a week. So theoretically, if you stay till 6 year, you'll be taught 6 times. And I think it's just about that culture of each school and what each local authority and region what wants to do. And I think that was maybe the beauty of the campaign and the programme that we put forward. It didn't mandate that you had to use BHF programmes. It didn't mandate that it had to be done by a charity. It could be done in partnership with the local first responder group or through the Save a Life for Scotland partnership. So I think the success in CPR training and DFib awareness comes through offering a platform that people can choose what suits them compared to mandating how it must be done, I think. And that's where we've certainly seen success across Scotland.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I think that's everything from me. I have had a message to say that our convener has been disconnected, so I'm also going to take over convening the meeting. So does any members have any additional questions? I think we've come to the end of our discussed questions. Is there anything else members would like to follow up and ask? Okay, and the convener had promised to take Stuart McMillan MSP back in. So, Stuart, I'll give you a chance to wind up on behalf of the petitioners. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener. Just a couple of points that I think would be extremely helpful for colleagues. Dr. Clegg spoke earlier regarding the when he referred back to Cathy Nor's opening comments regarding the fire extinguishers, and I fully support Dr. Clegg's comments there. I think the aspect regarding potentially considering health and safety legislation for non-residential buildings would be extremely useful and positive going forward. I'd like to highlight that the Jaden's Rainbow campaign, they are training people to actually use the machines that are put out into the community, so that the hosts are very much trained on them, but also there's a wider training campaign that has been taking place too, as well as the promotion of the locations of the DFibs that have been placed out into the community. Just wanted to make sure people were aware of that. So in terms of Inverclyde, that CPR training and also first aid training is very much pushed out and promoted, certainly throughout the schools, but also with the public, and that's undertaken by a variety of organisations, including Heartstart Inverclyde. I think the point regarding the top-down approach, I think the top-down approach can is very useful and very helpful, but I think it's also it can be quite limited. National campaigning can only do so much, but local events in our communities are always a stronger and more powerful message, and they've got a stronger resonance with the population. And I think Dr. Clegg's comments regarding Craig Miller actually highlight that, because I know certainly within Inverclyde, if it was just solely a campaign, a national campaign about the utilisation and also the number of DFibs within the community, then that would only go so far. Now, you need to have that public ownership and responsibility And Craig Miller is also one example, but certainly within Inverclyde, the Jaden Rainbow campaign has actually resonated with so many more people within the community. I think in terms of if there is going to be a top-down approach, it actually has to be done in partnership with local organisations and our local communities. And I think an ultimate point is certainly that Kathleen's she'd like to invite the panellists and also the committee to come to Inverclyde and meet with the Jaden Rainbow campaign, but also come and see what progress actually has been made regarding access, DFIBs, and also the training locally. And the final point is Kathleen would also like to put on record once again her public thanks to St Andrews First Aid for all of their assistance and certainly for the donation of 30 DFIB machines for the Inverclyde community. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stuart. And I must say, the piece that you read out at the start, thanks for doing that on behalf of the petitioner as well. It was a very powerful piece. So we have had the discussion. I'm just going to go back quickly to the panel. We mentioned at the start, somebody mentioned the bill by Anna Sarwar. We haven't seen the detail of that. Obviously, the consultation is just closed and we're waiting to see what the results are going to be. But I suppose on the general principles, and I'll come to you one at a time, and just a yes or a no would be fine, thanks. Do you agree with the general principles of the members' bill that Anna Sarwar is bringing forward? David?
On the spot, I think where it is designed to be a publicly accessible defibrillator, I think it would be helpful for it to be required to be registered with the ambulance service, and that way we could be confident it would be used if there was an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest in the area.
Okay, thank you. And Stephen?
Yeah, I have some anxieties round about it, if I'm honest. I do worry that if you have communities who are doing something in a well-meaning way, that to add some legislation into that might actually put them off doing the good work that they're doing.
Okay, that's an interesting point. And Dr. Clegg?
Yeah, I strongly support the idea that we should encourage registration of all public access defibrillators, otherwise they're not very useful. But I have real concerns about using legislation to try and enforce that. I think it may have negative unintended consequences.
Okay, thank you. And I mean, as with all bills, obviously it will be thoroughly scrutinised by the committees and then the Parliament itself. So if he does bring it forward, you'll all have a chance to feed into that. Can I go now to members for any comments or suggestions for action after we have heard that evidence? Tom Mason?
I mean, what we heard this morning is very interesting, and it is clear that there's work to be done in terms of coordinating everything together. And I think some leadership is necessary to make sure that this happens. And I guess to some extent, if a bill's coming, members' bills coming in, it might focus attention on the issues and get some. There seems to be various views as to what should be done, but I think a bill going through will focus the minds in one direction and should get some sensible outcome from the whole process, I hope.
Okay, Maurice Corey.
Deputy Convener, yes, a couple of points. Stephen Short raised a very interesting point just now about the not wishing to dilute the enthusiasm of our local communities in coming forward with supporting the placement of defibrillators, and I think that's important. And it's just a question of getting the balance. And as Tom Mason has alluded to, it's really there's several parts to this this egg, shall we say, and we need to make sure it's all good parts that we take forward. And I think Anasawa's proposed bill coming forward will be very interesting to concentrate our minds on this. The fact of the information we've gathered from our esteemed panel today has been extremely helpful, and I think it highlights the point, very, very important points that we need to have addressed. And I obviously was very interested in what Dr. McCaughan, Dr. Clegg said in relation to the factory spaces. And having been running factories in the UK, I understand that very fully, that I think that should be something that's in within the Factories Act, along with, as we know, fire safety equipment as well. So that's a point I would like to bring forward. But otherwise, no, I have no more to say. Thank you.
Thank you. And David Torrance.
Convener, with the sheer weight evidence that we've received this morning, to give it justification, I really would like to take this to another committee meeting so we can look at it all and bring it together and sit down and discuss it and see what direction the committee would like to go. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. And our convener is back, so it would be remiss of me not to ask her for her opinion on what we should do. Okay.
My apologies for that. I hope you can hear me now. I just wanted to say that I found the evidence really powerful. We had a petition on from St Andrew's First Aid around the importance of giving young people in particular the tools to be able to deal with something in their own communities. But the evidence around, which was true then and has been emphasised today, that you're disproportionately likely to have cardiac arrest in a poorer community and disproportionately unlikely to have somebody who's able to help you. And I think that, you know, that is a very powerful thing. The issue of leadership was struck me very strongly, and that just how getting this right can make an absolute practical difference in people's lives. And I do think there's a role for the Scottish Government. I'm very struck by the point that's made about the comparison with fire extinguishers. It just makes perfect sense to me that we should learn how to use these things and have the training and so on. So I suspect, as a committee, we don't really have enough time to bring in the minister before the Parliament rises. But I certainly think we'd want to get a response from the minister to the evidence that we've heard today about leadership and about the importance of that top-down, because I think that's what's behind the petition. There are things that can be done at a local level, but things that can be driven by a policy level, and I think that we should do that. And to reiterate the point I think I made at the beginning, that we would recognise just the strength of the petitioner in driving this, but we've seen today from the evidence we've heard why that has been so important. So I would certainly want to see that it would be the committee would hold on to until we get, you know, particularly the comments from Scottish Government, particularly around the challenges that are put to them by the evidence. Thank you, Deputy Convener.
Convener. Thank you, Convener. So we're agreed to write to the Minister to follow up on the evidence that we've heard today. So we will do that. It's a shame that we can't actually get them in for an evidence session, but obviously, as the convener has pointed out, we are very time limited now, so we'll have to take written evidence instead. So on that note, I would just like to thank everyone for coming in our panel. Your evidence, as always, is invaluable as to where we go now. I'd like to thank Stuart McMillan, MSP, for representing the petitioner. And I'd like to thank the petitioner, and that was a very kind invite to go and see how that's been working. And I'm sure we would all love to come to Inverclyde, but I think as a committee, our time is really wrapped up until the end. But that's not preventing individual members going along to see the work, the very valuable work that has been done. I'm going to pause now for a break, and we are going to come back at 11 o'clock. Thank you, everybody.
And I call the meeting back to order, and we can now move to the second continued petition for consideration today, which is petition 1683, support for families with multiple births, lodged by Jennifer Edmonston. Petition calls on the Scottish Government to provide better support for multiple birth families, including both financial and non-financial support. Considered at our meeting on 17 September, when the committee took evidence from the Minister for Children and Young People, Marie Todd. During the session, the Minister reiterated the measures that the Scottish Government has put in place to support vulnerable and low-income families. However, she stated that the Scottish Government does not see families who have twins or triplets as always being vulnerable. Although the Minister confirmed that the Scottish Government had not undertaken direct research to further its understanding of the impact on families of multiple births, she did indicate that the Scottish Government could work with Twin Trust to develop research. Following that meeting, the petitioner stated in correspondence with the clerks that she was pleased to hear that Marie Todd agreed to work with Twins Trust in order to undertake research into this area, and asked what progress is being made on this. In terms of this petition, one view was when the minister said that she does not see families who have twins or triplets as always being vulnerable. I don't actually think that's the argument. I think the argument is that there are particular things that come with multiple births that should be recognised in the support to families. And you know, I'd be interested in what other members feel, but I would be keen, I think, to hear from the minister on this question of research and whether that can be pursued. But I shall ask Tom Mason first for his comments.
Yes, I mean, we're still short of information from the Minister on this, and I think we should certainly write to her to get information as to whether they really talk properly to Twin Trust and what research is possible here. I think also we should establish what Cosler thinks in terms of the discretion which is available to local government on this issue. Before we and therefore keep it open at the moment to do just that. Yeah.
Thank you very much for that. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with my colleague. I think we should write to the Minister for Children and Young People to see exactly where they are with Twins Trust and then see how the work's been commissioned, what research has been done in there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Maurice Corrie.
Having been a father of twins, I understand these multiple birth issues, and I certainly agree with my colleagues about writing to the Minister and also to Cosler.
Okay, thank you. And Gail Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Good to have you back. I agree. I would write to the Minister to seek an update on the work ongoing with the Twins Trust, and also I think that something that I noted is a wee bit of a discrepancy. I mean, we could write to Cosler to ask about local authorities and how they, what their discretion is to provide daycare to two-year-olds. But there's a kind of missing time here between, I mean, maternity leave. Well, you could take maternity leave for 2 years, but you wouldn't get paid for it. So, you know, you've got your 9 months to a year maternity leave, and then you've got another year then before, if you get a discretionary place in a local authority. So, you know, that could be a year that could be really quite expensive if you used a childminder or any other private. But I don't know what the answer is to that, and I don't know who we can ask. And I suppose if the government have stated that, you know, there's no support for multiples in that situation, then, you know, I suppose we are where we are. But I would maybe like that included in the letter to the minister, just to see, you know, where that year, if there's anything at all that can be done. So yeah, I agree with writing to both of those, as has been stated. Thanks.
Okay. I mean, I think on that question of childcare, that the petitioner does make that point, that actually for a family who might have planned for a baby, who worked out how they're going, their childcare is going to be, that the consequence of having multiples is that they're more likely either to have to give up work or maybe reduce their hours and so on. And I just didn't feel that really the minister was getting that bit. It was as if it was, you know, it was a bit disadvantaged, but not recognising there are other things that come into families who maybe whose income is just kind of, you know, the balance that people are striking, increasingly having to strike. So I think we, you know, that would be something we'd want to flag up, because the petitioner herself did make that point. So I think there is a general consensus. We clearly recognise this remains an issue that we've got an interest in, and we want to check, you know, in terms of research and the work with Twins Trust, how's that been progressed, and raising this whole question of the impact of multiple births on family income, the capacity to work, but also try to COSLA to ask, you know, how they see this question of discretion being used. So if that's agreed, and it's a clear consensus in that one, can we move to the next continued petition, which is petition 1712, Soul and Conscience Letters, lodged by Laura Hunter. Petition calls on the Scottish Government to review the use of soul and conscience letters in criminal proceedings and to produce guidance for the courts and GP practices on the use of these letters, including alternatives to court appearances if an accused person is deemed unfit to attend in person. Since the last consideration of the petition in September 2020, the committee has received a written submission from the General Medical Council of Scotland. This submission explains that when providing a soul and conscience letter, a doctor has an obligation both to the patient and to the court. The GMC Scotland further explains that when writing a soul and conscience letter, doctors must ensure as much as possible that the report they provide is not false or misleading, is correct, does not deliberately leave out anything relevant, and is restricted to areas in which they have direct experience or relevant knowledge. Doctors must also make sure any opinion they include is balanced and be prepared to explain the facts and assumptions on which they are based. I think my own view on this is a really interesting petition, and I think the direct experience of the petitioner is quite strong in that sense, that perhaps there's a way of avoiding court by getting one of these letters. I did feel reassured that this was something that, you know, that people were aware of and they recognised there was an issue here. And again, struck by what the BMA said, which was you need to have a simple procedure. They're quite happy for it to be changed, but didn't want it to be overly bureaucratic. And I thought that it was thought provoking. I'm not sure, and I'll be interested in what members have to think whether there's anything further we can do this. I think we have, you know, the petitioners afford a good opportunity for this issue to be flagged up to the relevant organisations, but I'd be interested in people's views, starting with David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. With information that we've received, especially from the General Medical Council, where there's support and guidance available to doctors when writing a soul and conscience letter, and also the British Medical Association, Scotland and the Scottish Government have indicated that there's no concerns have been raised about quality of guidance regarding the writing of a soul and conscience letter, I'm quite happy to close the petition under Standing Rule 15.7.
Thank you, Maurice Corey.
Colleague David Torrance there on exactly the same points. I think it's the position now is to close the petition under Rule 15.7 standing orders on exactly those basis of there is evidence, there is information available. There has been no indications to of concerns to the British Medical Council or indeed the Scottish Government. And indeed, I think that the guidance is available from the General Medical Council in Scotland to assist doctors in writing soul and conscience letters, and it is up to them to follow that guidance, the doctors, if and when they have to write these letters. But again, overall, this overriding thing is that it's in the hands of the courts and the legal powers to make the final decision. So I would therefore invite that we close the petition on that basis. Thank you.
Thank you, Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I think David Torrance and Maurice Corey have covered everything. And, you know, in your opening statement, you're right in saying that this has brought it to the attention of these organisations. So I am also happy to close the petition. Thank you.
Tom Mason.
Convener, I agree with my colleagues and we should close the petition, given that we have assurances, as stated, from the Medical Council Association and so on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. So I think the committee's agreed to close the petition, but we are recognising this was a significant, important issue in terms of giving people confidence about the way in which the system operates. And we hope it has the petition recognises it has shone a light for these organisations on their responsibilities in this regard. And I want to thank the petitioner, in closing the petition, I want to thank them very much for engaging with the committee. They are, of course, able to bring a petition back in the same terms in the new parliament if they felt that this had not been progressed sufficiently. But there is clear, I think this was an important issue and one that we have, through the petition, have been able to encourage the relevant organisations to think about. So we can move to the next continued petition on our agenda today, which is petition 1793, Alleviation of Water Poverty, lodged by Gordon Walker. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to remove water and sewerage charges from all households in Scotland on a low income or benefits. Since the last consideration of this petition in September 2020, the committee has received written submissions from COSLA, Citizens Advice Scotland and the petitioner. These submissions are summarised in our meeting papers. And again, I think this was, I thought, a very interesting petition. And we did get, I thought, very interesting responses, particularly from Citizens Advice Scotland, and just the lack of awareness and this connection between the council tax and water and sewerage charges that people can, in terms of planning their budgets, be unaware of what this might mean. And in the context of these bills increasing over the next period of time, that's clearly something that would be of concern. But I'd be interested in members' views. I'll start with Maurice Corry.
Well, indeed. And having been a councillor myself, now going to be a council, this did come up at that stage in those years ahead before. I think particularly the Citizens Advice Bureau of Scotland has raised four very interesting points in relation to communications and the separation of water and sewage charges, and indeed amending the legislation and unfurling the basic financial support for low-income households. And I think at this stage we need to gather some more information, and also the fact of what COSLA has said as well in relation to consultations they've had. And they do, councils do respond sympathetically. I know from experience in that with constituents in certain circumstances, and they do go quite far to help. But nevertheless, I think we should write to the Scottish Government, convener, and seeking its views on the points raised by the Citizen Advice Scotland Bureau in its submission, and take it from there, I think, before we can to come to a final conclusion. Thank you.
Thank you. Gail Ross.
Thank you, convener. Yes, I would agree with Maurice Corry. I think that the evidence that we've had in advance of this meeting has given us a lot more clarity over what is payable and what is discountable. And it was good to see in the evidence that during the last months, councils have been exercising a discretion on a case-by-case basis about deferring council tax and water charges. But I think Maurice Corry is absolutely right. We do need to write to the Scottish Government. And I think that the Citizens Advice Scotland proposals need a further airing, so I would agree with that course of action. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom Mason.
Yes, I agree with my colleagues that the we need information from the Scottish Government on this. I mean, there is always confusion in terms of water services and misunderstandings in the public generally in terms of what is allowable for benefit and what is not is very confusing. So I think writing to the Scottish Government seeking more information is required at this stage. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. David Torrance.
Convener, I'm happy to agree with my colleagues with a course of action. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much for that then. There is clearly again a consensus, recognises this is an issue here, and we would want to see the Scottish Government response to the series of points that are made by Citizens Advice Scotland. I certainly think there is an interesting question around local authorities who are going to be under phenomenal pressure in terms of funding, and clearly there's a programme of increased water charges. How that is managed and how do we make sure that people who are in need are supported in the way that has been identified. So we're agreeing as a committee that we're going to write to the Scottish Government and ask for their response to Citizens Advice Scotland's submission. And I think there was a suggestion that we may want to look further at COSLA, but maybe I think that may be a miss. I'll check back on that one. It may be that we'd want to flag this up to COSLA again, but certainly in the first instance, writing to the Scottish Government. So we can move to the next continued petition on our agenda today, which is petition 1808, Remuneration of Vital Public Service Employees, lodged by Gerald Seenan. The petition calls on the Scottish Government substantially to increase the remuneration of vital public service employees, especially NHS and community care staff. Our last consideration of this petition in September, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the GMB, the Scottish Trade Unions Congress and Unison. Submissions have been received from the Scottish Government and Unison, and these are summarised in the clerk's note. I think there's a whole number of issues here. One is about who we value and what we've learned to value during the pandemic, and about the whole care sector and the importance of the different bits of that sector, where people work in the community, work in people's homes, as well as in care homes, and then the whole issue around the NHS. And you know, when at a time when everybody's incomes and work feels very fragile, I think this is an important area for us to be considering. But I'm going to call Gail Ross first.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, you're absolutely right. And I think we mentioned it last time about just who we should value. It was good to see that the Cabinet Secretary has agreed to open the pay settlement. So I would be interested to see how that's going. I know that the petitioner has a specific ask in terms of an uplift for the sector. So, I mean, is this done through national collective bargaining? Is it, you know, are there different sectors? I know that different levels of pay grade are applied in this sector. So, you know, how does that look on a national collective bargaining scale? Is this being done? If so, how is it being progressed? And if not, why not? What are the barriers to that? So certainly, I think more correspondence with the Scottish Government to pursue some of the petitioners' asks again, and also some of the stuff that's been brought up by Unison. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom Mason.
We're in. I mean, we're going to be, the budgets are going to be quite tight going forward, I guess. And we do need to acknowledge the commitment of the NHS workers and others in what has been going on over the past year, which also may continue. So we're not through the woods yet in terms of any of this. But I think clarification on procedures, I think, would be a very good point to progress this at this moment, so that we're absolutely clear what is going on, what issues are being taken into consideration, and get a much broader picture of the scope for movement here. So writing to the government, I think, is the key exercise in this case. Thank you.
Thank you. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I'd agree with my colleagues. I think we should write to the Scottish Government to seek their views on national collective bargaining, because it's important that everybody who not only has been working through this pandemic and in very important roles receives the pay that's required for the job that they do. And I've always felt that. And, so I'd be interested to hear the views of the Scottish Government.
Okay, thank you very much. And Maurice Corrie.
Yes, I declare an interest. One of my daughters works in the community care sector. But no, I would agree with my colleagues entirely that I think we need to seek the views of the Scottish Government, because this is a national issue. It is involving sectorial collective bargaining for the whole care sector. And this is quite a big issue, and I would commend it, along with my colleagues, to write to the Scottish Government. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Because I think there is an issue about when a local government puts out contracts into the third and private sector, whether they have been done in a sustainable way. So you can have a policy of having the living wage, but if you're not funding it through your contracts, I think there's a whole question about that. And I'd be interested if the Scottish Government is looking at that. And because it's one thing to have the policy, but if there's not the funding that goes behind it, if you're driving out costs into the system, then I think that that brings it its own series of pressures. But I think we are agreed we want to write Scottish Government on this question, national sectoral collective bargaining for the care sector, and to what extent are they, in funding local government, aware of the need to make sure that then the local government is able to develop contracts that mean that people are properly paid. Okay, thanks for that. If we can now move on to the next continued petition on our agenda today, which is petition 1811. Independent Sports Ombudsman, lodged by Ken White. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to establish an independent sports ombudsman to provide a duty of care to all participants, coaches, officials, support staff, volunteers and clubs, ensuring all are treated fairly and without prejudice, and review and arbitrate in disputes with Scottish governing bodies. Since our last consideration of this petition in September, we have received submissions from the Minister for Public Health, Sport and Communities, and two from the petitioner. In his submission, the Minister for Public Health and Sport notes he is confident that all SGBs have transparent policies and procedures in place to ensure that all members of the SGB and associated clubs are treated fairly and equally. The submission advises the Scottish Government want to see a fair and transparent sporting system in Scotland, and the Minister would be happy to give due consideration to any proposals brought forward with these intentions. Again, I think this is a really interesting petition. I think, as I said before, there are clearly investigations going on as we speak into some areas of sport where people who have participated at the very highest levels have complained about the way that they're treated. And I do think we need reassurances, as with our famous football petition, that when young people are going into sport, that their needs and interests are protected and they're not bullied, or that people who are engaging as volunteers feel that they're properly engaged. I guess I thought that the Minister took, I was surprised at how strong a position he took in saying that he had confidence that all have transparent policies. But of course, the petition makes clear it's one thing to have the transparent policies, but it's then a question of whether these are implemented or not. So, I certainly think that there is a little bit more that we should be doing in regard to this petition, because I didn't think, in the same way with the football petition, at first people said there's nothing to see here. I would need to feel there was a bit more confidence in exploring these matters, just because the whole question of safeguarding is so important. So I'm going to call members for their comments, but can I just remind them just to pause briefly to allow their microphones to be switched on before they speak. Okay, then we'll start with Tom Mason.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, we're short of information from the Scottish Sports Association in terms of what their views are on all this. But there seems to be a gap here, which is it might be a perceived gap, but I think we have to be absolutely sure that we have the information complete before we ever close this off. So writing to the Sports Association of their views on the various information we need will be the way forward here. Thank you.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Can I declare interest first that Ken White is one of my constituents, and I have been dealing with the club over the issues that they have had for governing body. And could I also say I don't have the same confidence as the Minister that supporting governing bodies are transparent and they implement them, Convener. And you could have a look at the statement from the Scottish Government. The Minister would be happy to give due consideration to any proposal brought forward with his intentions. And I think it's really important that an independent sports ombudsman is actually provided for all these sporting clubs, because you could have a look at the football petition that we were dealing with, and it only was dealt with in Parliament last week. I don't think that would have arisen. And you could have a look at even the most one that's highlighted just now from the Gymnastic Society and all the problems they have had. Would it have happened if you'd had an independent sports ombudsman there to go to? because in my view that some of these governing bodies just wash over the complaints and hide behind them in a lot of cases. So to me, this is a really important issue. And I'd like to write to the Scottish Sports Association just to see how it feels about it. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Maurice Corey.
Thank you, Convener. I would just like to thank the petitioner for bringing this petition forward. It's very interesting because obviously we've learned a lot ourselves as a committee in relation to the football petition, which we know about and have dealt with very recently. But I agree fully with what David Torrance has said in relation to the things like the football situation, the gymnastics situation would not probably have happened had this been in place and had the and an independent sports ombudsman been in place. So I would actually want to write to the Scottish Sports Association to basically seek its views on the action called for in the petition, and in particular trying to find out where these gaps are and ask them to identify where these gaps are, which the petitioner has alluded to. So I would support that move. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I mean, I now find myself agreeing in some cases with the petitioner. I mean, their second lot of evidence was very powerful in terms of their own issue with the complaints officer. So I would agree with my colleagues in writing to the Scottish Sports Association just to seek their views. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I think that there is a question to be asked about whether the solution that the petitioner identifies is the right solution. So I think in writing to the Scottish Sports Association, we maybe want to flag up to them, if not this, then what? Because I was quite struck by the petitioner saying, you know, we're told there's no further recourse. If you go to complaints office and they don't agree, there's no further recourse. That sense that matters aren't resolved. I think we're generally concerned about, and we'd certainly, you know, hope that the Scottish Government is also paying attention to the questions that we're pursuing. But in this instance, we are agreeing that we can see there's an issue here. What is the solution? And writing to the Scottish Sports Association, we hope will inform that thinking. Okay, if we can move on to the final continued petition on our agenda today, which is petition 1824, 30 days supply chain payment for government work lodged by Bill Alexander. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to ensure the 30-day supply chain payment policy is being complied with. Since our last consideration of this petition in October, we have received submissions from the Scottish Government and the Auditor General for Scotland. The Scottish Government advises it plans to establish a national framework agreement for civil engineering works and associated services. It anticipates the framework will become operational in summer 2021 and will be available to public bodies from across the Scottish public sector, and they will be obliged to implement the monthly reporting requirements upon contractors. The Auditor General for Scotland states that he will also ask the auditors of Transport Scotland, as a major procurer of construction contracts, to consider the scope for additional audit work in payment performance as part of the 2020-21 audit planning. Depending on the findings, we'll consider whether wider audit activity in this area is warranted. The Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee has heard evidence about the key role of public procurement in the Scottish economy and has agreed to carry out post-legislative scrutiny of the Procurement Reform Scotland Act. The committee launched a call for views on Friday, 9th of October 2020, and the deadline for submitting evidence is 18th December 2020. I should also add that Jackie Bailey had given her apologies. She attended the first hearing on this petition, is unable to be with us today because of other parliamentary commitments. But the question she poses is, if you don't check whether your policy has actually been delivered, is it a meaningful policy at all? And that's maybe me summarising her, but that sense that it's one thing to have something in place as good practice, but when do you check whether that is actually the case? In terms of what we do with this, I wondered whether it may be that we cannot do anything further on this, but that we could perhaps write to the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee and highlight the issues raised in the petition. I don't think it would be terribly valuable to refer it simply because of the procedure around what would happen at the end of the parliamentary year, but I would hope that it could be considered as part of their important work in this area. but I shall call other members for their views. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. With the work that the Scottish Government's doing around this and it coming into force in summer next year, and also the reassurance from the Auditor General for Scotland over issues that's been raised with procurement, I'm quite happy to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders. But like yourself, I would like to write to the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee to highlight issues raised in the petition so it be considered as part of the post-legislative work. Thank you.
Thank you. Maurice Corey.
Thank you, Convener. Again, I endorse what both yourself and as Convener and also David Torrens has just said, because I would be sufficiently happy to close the petition under the Rule 15.7 Standing Orders on the basis that the Auditor General obviously will task the auditors of Transport Scotland to consider the work, the additional audit work to in the payment performance as part of their audit to 2021. So I also, but I'm also keen to involve the energy and highlight the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee, as you said, to highlight these issues, and I think they're too important to let go, and particularly through this COVID pandemic and the issues we're going to have on the economy side as we come out of it, and for businesses and particularly small, medium-sized enterprises. So I would, as I say, wish that note to be put to the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee, having closed the petition on the basis that the two government bodies are actually looking into this and will carry out an audit. Thank you.
Thank you. Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I agree. And Maurice Corey makes a valuable point that it's more important now than ever to make sure that small and medium-sized businesses are being remunerated in a timely manner for the work that they are carrying out. Yet again, and we see this quite often in petitions, it's a disconnect between the policy and how it works in practice. So I would agree that I think we've taken it as far as we can in terms of our committee, but a note to the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee, who have been doing some work on this, would be a sensible thing to do, but I think that apart from that, we need to close it. But thank the petitioner, because it's a really interesting subject and it has thrown up quite a few subjects for us to look at. So thanks for that.
Thank you. Tom Mason.
Thank you, Davina. Colleagues have raised all the relevant points, I believe, and I agree with them. We should close the petition, but involve the Economy and Fair Works Committee in to carry on looking at these issues, make sure the gaps are maintained or continue to be looked at, should there be any, during this present economic crisis we're going to go through. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think there is a consensus that we should close the petition. The issues have been highlighted to the Auditor General and to the Scottish Government. The question of the gap between the petition is, I think, important, and we would agree to write the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee and hope that these issues could be considered as part of their post-legislative work. And we could highlight to the petitioner that they may wish to engage with the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee on this work. And obviously there's an opportunity to make a submission there. But I think in agreeing to close the petition, we're recognising just how important this can be for small businesses. Late payment can sometimes end up with companies going to the wall, and therefore it's really, really important, I believe, that the public sector leads the way in this and has best practice. But we want to thank the petitioner for the engagement with the process and encourage them to follow the work of the Energy Committee in this, the Economy Committee in this regard. If we can now move to Agenda Item 2, which is the consideration of new petitions. The first new petition on agenda today is Petition 1827, Support for First-Time Buyers in Areas with Higher House Inflation, lodged by Chloe Bird. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to increase the Help to Buy threshold to £250,000 and to extend the deadline of the First Home Fund. Members will recall that the committee agreed to seek advance views from the Scottish Government on all new petitions before they are formally considered. Despite repeated requests for this information, the Scottish Government has not been forthcoming with its views on this petition. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestion for action. I found reading the material around this very interesting, because there's always that balance to be struck between generally supporting first-time buyers, but recognising the challenges in particular for particular groups who are, well, for a lot of young people, are not able to accumulate the capital to put down a deposit, even if they could afford to buy a house. And this question of why the threshold was reduced in order to make sure that the support was more targeted, but also the arguments in the other direction. So I think it's a shame that we haven't heard from the Scottish Government on this, because it's clearly an area where, over a long period of time, there's been work done, and actually the extent to which this kind of intervention supports first-time buyers. But I'll ask members for their response. Maurice Corrie?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, a very interesting one indeed. And as you say, the information surrounding it was actually quite an eye-opener. I think, again, I come back to my comment on the previous petition, where we are at very difficult economic times, and I think this has got to be re-looked at. And I think we've got to get back to extract from the Scottish Government some information and their views. And I think we must write to the Minister for Local Government, Housing and Planning to seek that and the action that they're going to take, which is called for in the petition. And I'd like to thank petitioner for bringing this forward, because I know I am father to young people on that threshold and looking to buy their first home or somehow acquire the money for the deposit and save it. And I know how jolly difficult it is. And I certainly think we need to look deeper into this. And I would commend that that action is taken to write to the minister in the first instance. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Gail Ross.
Thanks, Convener. I find this one very interesting as well. And I was interested in the Spice paper about how the Help to Buy started out and the threshold and then how it was brought down. And now in Scotland, we're looking at affordable homes being the driver. I just wondered when, I agree absolutely to write to the minister. We have to get Scottish Government views on this. But I did read in the papers that in England they are doing a cap scheme based on different areas. And I found that really interesting because, coming from a rural area where houses are infinitely more affordable than they are, even in Inverness, but certainly in the bigger cities, a cap even of 200,000 would buy you a pretty good house up here in Caithness. Whereas you probably get, not as much for your money in the bigger cities, as we've seen. So I wonder in that letter if we can ask if they've considered doing, a difference for different areas as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom Mason.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, a very complicated and difficult area. I like Morris. I'm involved in trying to sort out purchases for my family or daughter, whatever, and it's very difficult. And I think we need to explore from the government exactly what is available at the moment, and any possible innovations that can take place, because certainly the situation at the moment remains very difficult. And if there are local variations that can be brought in as scale as indicated, I think that might be very suitable. Because there are great differences between the northeast and the central belt, rural as opposed to urban areas. All of these need to be taken into consideration, and we need to have information on these. So write to the minister and try to get them to explore quite widely what their views are in terms of various options. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I'm fully supportive of my colleagues' right to Minister for Local Government, Housing and Planning to seek his views. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I think we should write in the terms described. I think the point that Gail makes is absolutely right. Even within urban areas, there can be huge gaps in or discrepancies in the value of the property. £200,000 in some parts of Glasgow wouldn't get your two-bedroom flat. But there is also a question. I think I'm quite interested in the how the government thinks about the balance of spending within supporting first-time buyers. There is a thing about young people not being able to buy a house, now renting and effectively paying somebody else's mortgage for them. So it may be that there are how else money's been spent in housing around affordable housing for rent and so on as well. But particularly would be welcome their comments clearly on what the petitioner has flagged up, which I think is a sense that perhaps access to support is not matching the price of properties in some parts of Scotland. So we look forward to a response from the Minister in that regard. If we can move to the second new petition on our agenda today, which is petition 1828, Improve Opportunities for Employment, lodged by Matthew Goundry. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to ensure that people using Skills Development Scotland funded welfare to work agencies can access employment opportunities in any area of the country. In its submission, the Scottish Government explains that employability services delivered by local authorities are funded by those local authorities. As a result, they are only available to residents, and there is no obligation on local authorities to widen that scope. As this is a decision for local authorities, the Scottish Government has no jurisdiction and states it is unable to intervene. In his written submission, his view, he's been denied opportunities based on location, explaining that he needs access to advertised jobs. I think this is I'm not sure if there's more that we can do, but I'd be interested in people's views. But what I did think was, it's really not sufficient for the Scottish Government to say this is a matter for local authorities who they are funding on this question. There's nothing they can do, because there are clearly Scottish-wide organisations, Scottish-wide initiatives, like the job guarantee, the youth job guarantee. And I suppose the question is, I am assuming the argument is that these are best delivered locally. But does that mean that it's maybe something that's maybe more obvious in the central belt? So, for example, as a metropolitan area around Glasgow, that where there may be opportunities delivered within the Glasgow local authority, the people outside Glasgow but very close to it may see that's a natural employment travel route for them. So I found that quite interesting, but I'm not sure to what extent this is something that is. That we were able to do any more about, but I'll call members. Gail Ross.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I found this one really interesting and really quite frustrating, because there was a note in it about wanting to apply for a job that was 6 miles away and being barred from doing that for some reason. Now, I mean. Coming from where I come from in Caithness, people travel miles locally to get to their work. So I just found that bizarre, to say the least. I also find it really frustrating that local authorities don't have some mechanism to signpost people to other local authorities, because, as you say yourself, there's big miles between local authorities. Well, obviously Highland is. We could travel within Highland, and that is hundreds of miles. But, you could be on the cusp, as you say, of one local authority and another, and be, not be able to access the jobs in one that's maybe just a couple of miles away. I don't understand why that could be. And I don't understand why, as I said, there isn't a mechanism for local authorities to signpost between local authorities. I'm really quite... really, for the first time in this committee, stuck as to where to go with this one, because I do think that the petitioner has a really, really valid point. And as you say yourself, there are nationwide schemes, and certainly up here we've got voluntary websites and stuff that post job applications from other places. And as the petitioner pointed out as well, in this moment in time where a lot of people have been made redundant, they could be looking for employment opportunities elsewhere in Scotland. So I really don't want to close it, but I think we've come up against a bit of a wall. And to me, that's really, really frustrating, because I think there probably are things that can be done. But I will also wait and see what other members think, because I think this, it deserves a lot more discussion, but I really am stuck as to where we take it now.
Thank you. Tom Mason?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, Gail has really summed up my thoughts as well. I mean, essentially, the government has come back with what is, as opposed to what should be. And we need to explore that, what should be, or what, and if we were restricting job opportunities purely to local authority areas, we're doomed before we start. There's going to be a lot of people in this position over the next year who need to explore avenues. I mean, it's not only going within Scotland. It could well be that they have to go elsewhere in UK to find employment. And we really need to explore this much further. So certainly closing it off at this stage, to me, is not an option. And I think we should go back to the government and say, well, if that is the answer you've got, what should this particular person be doing to obtain a job? Or are they going to live off of the state for the next year and a half in terms of universal credit, which is unsatisfactory? And we mustn't choke the young people off or anybody off who's able to seek a job and it's limited in terms of where they can obtain that employment. So explore with the government, and maybe we should be looking at trying to some other organisations as well in terms of what solutions should be. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. Very sympathetic to the petition. I believe we should be writing to COSLA, because these local authorities are given funding to create jobs in their area. And a lot of them have done in areas of deprivation. So I would seek the views of COSLA, because the Scottish Government's already given us its views. I don't know where we could take this petition. I wouldn't like to close it, but I don't think there's anything else we could do. But it'd be interesting to see here the local authorities' views on this, because it is they're creating employment in their area. And I know it does affect somebody who could be a mile away from a boundary of a local authority, and it's very, very difficult to take. But I can see where the local authorities are coming from in this site. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Maurice Corrie.
Very important.
Sorry,
can you hear me now?
Just not now yet.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. I'm actually very interested in this particular petition, and I think that the petitioner has raised a very valuable point. And Tom Mason's comment about, you know, local authorities should be saying what should be the case and how should they deal with this. And I'm slightly staggered, because in my experience, when I was out of work and I got support from the job agency, the job centres in my area, I was not restricted anywhere within the area. In fact, they were offering to fund me to go down south to look at a job interview in London. So I can't understand it, why this person has been stopped from looking for a job. It may be down at a desk level where somebody hasn't quite got the message on this, because I'm staggered that this has happened. And I think if we go back and write also to the DWP and the job centres, I think we need to get some answers from them if this is happening, because there's something wrong here. And I think also we need some more joined up thinking with local authorities to work cross border. But I certainly, from the experience I've had and from certainly my own family and people I know and constituents as well who've gone through this, I've never known anybody to be really restricted in this way. So there's something not right somewhere. And I agree with David Torrance, but I think we should also write to COSLA as well.
I think my sense of this is a slightly different issue, which is about how people are supported in terms of employability, training, preparation for access to work, and being supported to apply for jobs, which would target people who are further away from the labour market, who are, would target people who are needing a bit more support. So I don't think it's a DWP, I think it's the employability agencies at a local level. And I'm quite torn about this because I think certainly in Glasgow, I like to see resources targeted on need and other people. You know, it is true that people can still apply for jobs, but I think part of the problem has been that the Scottish Government response has been too kind of just, well, that's the way it is. This is a matter for local authorities, therefore not a matter for us. While at the same time they have agencies, while at the same time they fund a lot of this, and they have agencies that are delivering on that kind of work. So I think perhaps the characterisation by Tom Mason is the right one, which is that may be the case, but should it be? And I would quite like to, I think, to go back to Scottish Government and ask them to reflect on that discussion, but to write to COSLA too about how this whole question is being managed, because everyone makes the point that we're facing an employment crisis in the next period, and it's essential that where there is public money going in, that it's used to the very best effect. I'm seeing that Morris wants to come back in. Morris Corey?
Gavina, thank you. Yes, I do. On that point, yes, just to sort of expand slightly what I was saying, is Skills Development Scotland actually offers some very good support and help. And I've witnessed that in several cases in my region of younger people. So, yeah, just to confirm, I was talking about travel to job opportunities in that case where the support was given by DWP and job centres. But in relation to actual training and skills development, yes, it's there. But again, the SDS is, of course, a national body, so the Scottish Government does have responsibility to come back to that. And I think they've got some questions to answer. Thank you.
OK, thanks. I think there is a recognition that in these times, we want to make sure that we are asking the right questions around people's opportunity to access employment opportunities. There will be rules there for reasons. I think we as a committee are looking for reassurance, particularly because we are in these very uncharted waters and people are facing really quite frightening circumstances and feeling a sense of a great sense of fragility, I think, in terms of employment. So I think we're agreeing to write to Scottish Government and to COSLA really to reflect the discussion we've had. If that's agreed, we can now move on to the next new petition on our agenda today, which is petition 1829, allow a designated visitor into intensive care wards, lodged by Tracy Phillips. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to allow a designated carer or family member into intensive care wards to visit, support and care for their loved ones. In her submission, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport explains that hospital visiting restrictions were put in place in response to the coronavirus outbreak. However, from 13th of July, patients could receive visitors. The Cabinet Secretary goes on to state that additional visiting restrictions have been reimposed in areas which have been increases in cases. However, essential visits have always been permitted. This covers visits such as a parent accompanying a child or a birth partner, supporting a woman during hospital visits, when someone has reached the end of their life, when people have a mental health issue such as dementia, autism or a learning disability, and not seeing a loved one could cause distress. The Cabinet Secretary further explains that the guidance makes clear that other people who are in attendance to support the needs of the person in hospital, such as a carer, supporter, personal assistant, should not be counted as an additional visitor. Since the publication of her meeting papers, the petitioner has provided a written submission which has been circulated to members ahead of our meeting today. In her submission, the petitioner explains that her sister has sadly passed away since the publication of her petition. She describes how difficult it is when loved ones cannot visit, both for them, but more importantly for those patients who are in ICU. And she also explains the positive impact the face-to-face visits had on her sister, making her so happy and allowing her to make clear her wishes. I think the committee as a whole would want to express our condolences to the petitioner and recognise just how difficult and how personal this has been to her and her family, and we can only imagine the impact it has had on them. But I do think that she's highlighting a really, really important issue that perhaps all too many of us are aware of in these times. these very difficult times. I wonder if I can call Tom Mason first.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Yes, is it, I mean, this is a very important issue, and my condolences go out to the petitioner, and must be a very, very sad time for her. I think we should, we do need to explore this a bit further, and I think writing to the NHS Scotland about how consistently the guidance is being applied, I think, is important. I mean, that would establish exactly what they believe the guidance is, any, deal with any perceptions which may be misguided, and in order to make sure that this situation is dealt with in a kindly and sensible manner forward, because we certainly can't continue on the way we are as coming through the news in various places. So writing to NHS, I think, is the important part here. Thank you.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with Tom Mason. I think we should write to NHS Scotland to ask how consistency over the guidance is applied in our hospitals. I don't think there's anything else I could add to that. So thank you, Convener.
OK, thank you. Maurice Corrie.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I would agree with both my colleagues Tom Mason and David Torrance there. I think we should write to NHS Scotland, just find out how this guidance is being applied and is it consistent throughout the care network. Thank you.
Thank you. Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I agree with that course of action. Nothing further to add apart from sincere thanks to the petitioner and to echo your comments at the start.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we are recognising there's an issue here, and it's one that's touched a lot of people. And the question is not just about the guidance, but how consistently the guidance on visiting is being applied. We're agreeing to write to NHS Scotland in that. I wonder whether, as part of that, there is an issue that, given the circumstances we're in, that even where the guidance says one thing, at a local level, people will be risk averse because of the consequence of the whole publicity around all of this. And I think that might be something that, how do they give local care settings the confidence to actually apply the guidance and the health settings itself. So I think that would be something we would want to take forward. And again, a record of thanks to the petitioner. The next new petitioner agenda today is petition 1831, End the Ban on Background Music, lodged by Michael Grieve. Petition calls on the Scottish Government to end the ban on background music in hospitality venues. The Scottish Government advises an expert advisory group is taking forward the task of looking at how guidance can be developed by the hospitality sector for safe management of low-level background sound. This work is ongoing and further updates will be provided by Scottish Government in due course. Since the publication of our papers, the petitioner has provided a written submission, which has been provided to members ahead of our meeting. This submission highlights the results of a report which was prepared in response to the publication of the statutory guidance. The petitioner states that this report reflects the results of other relevant published studies and provides a clear indication that well-managed background amplified audio can be safely reintroduced to hospitality settings without increasing the risk of significantly increased vocal effort or breaching physical distancing requirements. I would be interested in what other members think about this. It's clear the Scottish Government is now doing a bit of work on it, but it worries me that it's very slow, that we're having an expert advisory group and it's going to look forward and forward. Now, where I'm living, we aren't in hospitality settings at the moment. We know how badly they've been affected. I've been told anecdotally by people who work in the sector that, in fact, having no music and no background sound actually means either people, in order to avoid being heard, lean into each other more and actually are in closer contact with each other. And I've also been told that it doesn't actually make things quieter, that there's still a lot of noise and it's a different kind of noise. And my own feeling is that this is I'd recognise that an expert advisory group is looking at this. I've not seen the evidence that says that this is something that is effective, but maybe that's something that we could get. But I'm torn whether, because it's been considered elsewhere, whether we realistically can do anything more. But that is certainly my own concern, would be the sense of the pace at which the Scottish Government would be working on this. But I'll call David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. The petitioner's words there, well managed, is key to this. Can you guarantee it being well managed in these circumstances? And the Scottish Government's working on this. We've got an expert advisory group, which is developing guidance for the sector for safe management of low-level background noise. And I know it's been a wee bit slow to report, but I'm quite happy to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of standing orders on the basis that the Scottish Government's doing work in this area, and it will report back.
Thank you. Maurice Corey.
Yeah, I think, Convener, as David Torrance has said, and indeed you've alluded to as well, I think this is a different one, torn between two ships here. I think that whilst the establishment of the expert advisory group has been delayed by the coronavirus constraints and various levels being restricted in areas, it's obviously not been able to proceed at pace, as they use the expression. So I'm keen to see what's the outcome of that. Maybe we could put some pressure on the government to as a committee to increase this pace or get it back onto the rails again, because I'd want that assurance in closing the petition. So I think at this stage, to be clear, I would close the petition on under Rule 15.7 standing orders on the basis that we write to the Scottish Government about the pace of this advisory group and ensure that we get some confirmation of that to develop the guidance for that sector for the safe management of low-level background noise. Because I think, as a petitioner quite rightly says, is that the music is vital to mental health and well-being, and somebody who might just go into the place and not go in on their own might just want to listen to music while they're having a meal or having a drink or coffee or whatever it might be, apart from communicating with other people. So, as I say, I would like some assurances from the Scottish Government on the basis if we were to close it. Thank you.
Thank you. Jill Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I was really interested to see, especially in the additional evidence that we received after our papers, that the study that, you know, raises quite a lot of questions in my mind. I mean, I think that certainly in a situation like this, I mean, background music is different in different places. It can be quite easy listening, and in other places it tends to be a little bit louder. But I suppose the regulations, if the Scottish Government did bring it back in, would be, you know, how loud is allowed, and all these different things to take into consideration. So I would imagine that the working group is looking at all these things. So I'm also conflicted. I mean, I love music and I love listening to it in different settings and environments, but I do think that, you know, this action has been taken for a reason, and, you know, we've never had to do this before, so it's really difficult to know what the right thing is, I suppose, and I'm glad that I'm not the person making the decisions. But I do trust that this expert group is looking at all these things. Possibly, you know, it could be done a little bit quicker. So I'm happy enough to, whilst being really sympathetic to the point that the petitioner is making, to close the petition, but to write to the Scottish Government to just reiterate all the things that we have discussed and that the petitioner has brought to her attention as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom Mason.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with Maurice and Gail. I think we should close the petition, but we do need information as to whether the scope of the and that's going to be done in a reasonable, timely manner to get some fairly early answers. So closing, but getting some assurances in terms of progress. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for that. My own feeling is that, yes, it probably realistically is that we would close the petition, but that we would highlight Scottish Government just how much evidence matters in this regard, and also the impact, in my view, on the hospitality sector of not being able to have background music. I think it's a, as someone I know who works in the sector said to me, it's a very different experience to go in for a meal and there to be no music and all you hear are the waiters and serving staff scraping about in the background. And I think, you know, some in the hospitality sector have flagged that up. So I think it would be realistically, in terms of our consideration of the petition, again, we're up against parliamentary timetables. We wouldn't be able really to do more. But I think, given that the Scottish Government is acting as we would want to flag up these serious concerns about a policy which has a significant impact, and there's a question mark over the health benefits and the evidence of it. So we would be agreeing to close the petition. We'd want to thank the, we'd be agreeing to write to the Scottish Government about really reflecting our discussion just now. But we want to thank the petitioner. We recognise it's a really important issue that people, that, and to give them the reassurance that actually it's a very live subject in the Parliament itself. And a number of MSPs have been making this case very strongly. So it's not that this argument won't stop here. But we want to thank them for their engagement with the committee. The final new petitioner agenda today is Petition 1832, Repeal the Public the Public Interest Disclosure Act 1998, PIDA, lodged by Jacqueline Shaw. The petition calls on the Scottish Government to urge the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to request that the UK Government repeals the Public Interest Disclosure Act 1998. The Scottish Government submission is confident that NHS Scotland's whistleblowing measures build on and go further than current PIDA legislation and address the requirements outlined in this petition. These measures include the role of non-executive whistleblowing champions and that they have a direct escalation route to the Health Secretary, the new role of the Independent National Whistleblowing Officer, INWO, which will be undertaken by the SPSO. A confidential advice line is available for anyone who works for NHS Scotland to discuss a whistleblowing concern. And concerns can also be raised with Health Improvement Scotland, which has a duty to respond to potential concerns raised by NHS staff about patient safety, quality of care within NHS boards. This clearly is a question that we have looked at in the past around whistleblowing and confidence that people can have in whistleblowing, and I read the papers with interest, and we interested in the views of the of members in this regard. And I could start with Maurice Corry.
Thank you, convener. Yes, this is another one where I think it falls into two areas. Whilst the government, the Scottish Government, obviously is bringing forward its Public Information Disclosure Act 1998, and it's been strengthened by the additional whistleblowing measures and the role of the non-executive whistleblowing champions and the confidential advice line, there are still issues which I think has been very validly raised by the petitioner, where they go on to say that there's no route been identified directly to the whistleblower, whereas there is a direct escalation route to the Health Secretary. So there's an imbalance there, which I would like to see resolved. And I think further to that, that Robert Francis QC, in his statements, has obviously said that the confidential lifeline, the advice line, is extremely important as an independent assessor. So I think we've got to give the government a chance, because obviously this is coming into effect in 2021, the Independent National Whistleblowing Officer. And therefore, we need to ensure that that works and to give them a chance to put that into place. So therefore, I've been minded to close petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, but on the basis, again, that we write to the Scottish Government to ensure that this route to the direct escalation route to the Health Secretary is also applied simply to the whistleblower as well. And I'd like to see that done, and also the independent status of the confidential advice line, is it well implemented as well? So it's yes, close the petition, but frankly, it needs to be supported with a written writing to the government to ensure certain of these two aspects are put in place. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I should have flagged up, of course, that since our papers were published, we've received a written submission from the petitioner refuting much of the Scottish Government submission. I think that's informed some of the conversation so far. Can I call Gail Ross?
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I mean, the additional evidence, again, was really quite enlightening, and it's not the first time that we've had such a polarised view between what's happening and, you know, what's perceived as should be happening. I think that Maurice Corey is absolutely right. We should be looking for or certainly flagging up the discrepancies that we're seeing here. But again, as a petitions committee, I don't know if there's anything else that we can do. But on saying that, you know, the extra evidence that the petition has put in certainly might well be worthwhile doing something in our legacy paper to flag up to another committee for next term. I do think that there are quite a lot of really important points in here that I wouldn't like to see being lost. And, you know, the petitioner obviously has spent a lot of time with this, and, you know, I'd like to thank them very much for that. So, you know, if there was a way to flag this up in our paper, then I would be happy to close on the basis of also doing what Maurice said and flagging up again to the Health Secretary. Thank you.
Thank you. I should say that Tom Mason has had to leave the meeting for another urgent meeting, and so obviously want to acknowledge his contributions today and call Tom David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with my colleagues that if we close the petition under 15.7 of standing orders, that we should still write to the Scottish Government. I know the measures will be put in place next year, and the petitioner has the opportunity to come back in a year's time if they don't feel that these measures are sufficient. So that's all I've got to say on that. Convener.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think that the committee is reflecting the dilemma here that the petitioner is highlighting concerns about the actual way in which this is going to be. We're also trying to be honest about whether in the time that we have left between now and next April, whether we can actually progress the big issues that are flagged up here. I think perhaps a suggestion has been made that we would flag this in to our legacy paper, that this is something maybe that you know, that we might want to think about where this may go. But actually, I think the point made at the end there is maybe the most reassuring one to the petitioner, that they can return with this petition. And in fact, because it will be a new parliament, the years limit doesn't apply to them, so they would be able to bring that in. It will, of course, obviously be subject to the amount of time that the Public Petitions Committee is able to give to any individual petition. We always are wrestling with this balance between considering what we have in front of us and recognising there are other people who have to have their petition heard as well. But my sense is, and if people can disagree with me, that we are agreeing to close the petition, but that we will look through our legacy paper at a mechanism of flagging up this issue, and that we would thank the petitioner for their engagement and hope that the fact that they can return to this question in the new parliament is something that would give them some reassurance. So if that's agreed, and I don't see any dissent to that, I think we are reaching the conclusion of our meeting. I just want to thank everybody, perhaps particularly the Deputy Convener for stepping in when my Wi-Fi has let me down yet again. But I think that we've had a really important discussion, a whole range of issues, and just to repeat, my sense is that, again, people, as petitioners, being willing to bring forward their own direct experience does have a huge impact on all of us. And no matter what our decisions and individual petitions are, I'm sure that people recognise that we want to take all of them seriously, because they have been sufficiently serious for petitioners to bring them to our attention. And again, to thank broadcasting and the clerking team for managing, which is a much more complex process than if we're all in a committee room. So with that, can I thank everyone for their attendance and close the meeting.